podcast is sponsored by The Crazy Cast and Human Wire Productions at human-wire.com.
And The Gypsy Haven, Elgin's only witch shop at www.thegypsyhaven.com and online Wiccan supplies.com.
Two witches.
You mean like witchcraft?
Sharing their opinions and beliefs about the practice and theory of magic.
Must be the season of the
Hey guys, this is Feather
and LeFay,
and welcome back to Season of the Witch.
We've got a really interesting episode for you guys coming up. This is episode 4. We're getting there. It's starting to become a real thing.
I mean, like, it's gone.
No,
this is just the beginning.
We're here to stay. So quick synopsis for everyone, what to look forward about. We are going to go briefly into April's full moon. That's April 22nd. Yay. Then we decided we wanted to cover altars.
Yes.
Something that is going to be brought up quite often in rituals, in different things coming around for the different seasons. So why not go into that a little bit? And then
how about new?
How about yes? Yeah, you just sit there and swallow it.
Headshot.
You say that way, like you know how to say that way too many times. And then there's one topic that
I'm
Feather's
like dying,
bursting to talk about
psychic vampires.
Yeah. So this is going to be an interesting. There's a lot to cover, but some really fun things. Hopefully that
Woo-hoo.
People will know how to deal with it as it comes up. But I know that was really loud, and I shouldn't talk into a microphone. Sorry. I wanted to just shout out because I was so excited today. I started off really worried that I was going to be sniffling all throughout the show, and I know this is not a common practice use, but so happened that our friend David of Bewitching Wands, he's awesome, and I happen to have my own wand from him that I'm ever so proud of. David happened to drop off some of his chili powder, and this powder is ridiculous.
Deadly.
It's amazing. Okay, it's delicious. And for
I trust you.
For all the spiceaholics out there, I'm just going to just rant about this because I took just the itty bitty
little. Yeah.
I just took enough, like a cup, not
like
even.
Four granules or
not,
something.
Well, I took a bigger chunk. You didn't see me take that bigger chunk, so maybe not even a half a teaspoon. That cleared up my sinuses like no other. And I looked at the ingredients and no wonder there's ghost pepper, there's jalapeno, there's orange habanero. The list is huge. But
there's like 30 different peppers in that thing.
I'd say like at least 20.
Yeah.
It looks like 20. And I just wanted to rave about that a little bit. So if we've got people that are into locally sourced ingredients. David's the bomb. And he's got a Facebook page. I'm not sure how else to promote him at the moment, but if you reach out, look for Bewitching Wands on Facebook, and I'm sure he's got some chili for you, and it's amazing.
And his wands are in my shop at the Gypsy Haven,
they're so gorgeous.
Handcrafted
with love and more care than I have the patience for.
Yeah.
I will fully admit that.
Well, we'll leave that to him. He's the expert.
And then lastly, we have a new sponsor to bring up. So this one's kind of cool. It's King of Hearts Tattoo, and he's in Fox River Grove now. So it's our friend Keith over at King of Hearts Tattoo, and those guys are amazing. I've had most of my work done by Keith himself. I really don't like letting other people work on me unless I trust and know that I'm going to a safe and secure place.
Mm-hmm.
So Keith is the guy to go to, and if you got the best way to make sure that you get them is tell him that the witch has sent you. he'll know what that means.
He hasn't drilled on me yet. I'm pretty loyal to my old faithful, but I don't know. I'll think about it.
There's new people.
Huh?
There's new people and new artists and new styles.
Yes, yes.
And he doesn't drill really that bad.
I like using that word, though.
Well,
drill are you going to be? Yeah,
you know, like I've had a guy that drilled into me, and the experience so much different. I will say Keith knows how to do the pressure right.
Okay.
That is my highest, thing I can say about him in general, is he does not make the experience worse than it has to be.
That's half the fun. I'm joking.
Okay, but you're a bit of a sadist and a masochist in general, so we'll take it at that.
Okay,
so now that we've got that out of the way, mm-hmm. why don't we dive right into, okay, briefly, because we're not going to go over Esbit's in their entirety, but we just wanted to remind everybody,
yes,
what's coming up.
April's full moon.
So, also known aka the pink moon, that's happening on April 22nd. Do you want to go into anything about the astrology? I know that it's going into Scorpio.
Yeah, I don't have my planner in front of me either, so I did not anticipate going terribly deep into this month's S-Bot. I just want everybody to be aware of it. Cleanse your stuff. Cleanse your stones and your tools, and then get them out there. You know, put them in your windows and... But as far as astrology, no ma'am, not this time around. I'll get you next time, though, I promise.
I like being warned about the retrogrades, so yeah. I figured at least mention that for everybody, just so that we're aware of some crazy stuff that might be coming into play.
Well, we're still in Jupiter's in retrograde until when? Jupiter, March, May?
No!
La, 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 la. The beginning of May sometime, so if your financial world is still in an uproar, that's why, and you're not alone.
Oh.
You know, a whole lot of people are in financial crisis right now, jobs and everything else. So
it's IRS season, too.
Yeah, it just sucks, but it will be over.
I think you couldn't possibly be any dumber.
Ooh. Okay. I don't know how that has to do anything with Jupiter, but okay. Jupiter, you're dumb.
He's shaking his head. He's like, no,
stop it. But
that would be the Mercury in retrograde.
Mercury in retrograde, that's going to be everybody's motherfucker.
And
we all hate that.
It starts April 22nd or 28th.
28th.
And goes to the 22nd. So at least it's not in it for a long period of time.
4 to 6 weeks. It's never ending. Yeah. So Mercury will be in retrograde. So your communication's going to be all out of whack. Everybody says it's okay. Again, we're not gonna go.
No, we don't have to go deep into it. Okay. I just wanted to at least warn everyone about Mercury. That tends to be my motherfucker. I don't like dealing with it. Generally, the other planets, yes, they are affecting me, but they're not
nearly as intense as Mercury.
Not as obvious. Right. So just be wary. It's gonna be coming up soon. If things start going into a wacky mode,
you're not crazy.
Yeah,
it's affecting all of us. So
now to the fun one.
Yay.
Well, the other fun one.
Yeah, right.
So, altars. Something that every witch, I think a lot of religions in general, mm-hmm. tend to make these, whether they know it's an altar, whether they're just putting their pretty shiny sparkly things in mm-hmm. one place. It's a human nature thing that is important to the pagan path in a lot of different ways.
Right. And should we start off by talking about different types of altars or the tools that we're going to put on altars first, and then we can mix and match? What do you think?
I mean, there's kind of things that a basic building blocks to an altar, and then as you go on, you can use those different blocks for different things.
Okay.
So generally, I mean, I like going into what makes it and then what can you do with it.
Oh,
but a lot of people might be more excited about hearing what you can... so in that sense, maybe... Let's go into what you can do with them real quick, or with the different kinds, and then we can go into more of the factoids.
Okay.
So.
Okay, Pink Panther. Straight on out of here.
Thank you. I've got just a basic list, just because for me, an altar, I'm a little limited personally at the moment, as mm-hmm. soon as I have my own space.
Mm-hmm.
My husband's probably going to get very sick of seeing all the different altars I have.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would want one, I would definitely need to have one in my bedroom.
Okay.
Which is more my personal altar.
Right.
Something that is not going to be seen by the public, something that would not be, my husband can see it, but maybe the cats have no access to it. It's all my really important stuff, the deities that I want to connect with.
Shall not pass!
There's that threshold.
I tend to call that more of a shrine mm-hmm. type of thing when it's dedicated to deities. You know, everybody has different
terminology.
Exactly. And I have one in my bedroom as well, and it's actually dedicated to two different deities.
Right. You mentioned that.
Yeah. I spoke about that in previous podcasts, and that's the one where Yeah, it is for deities. That's the one that when I wake up in the morning, that's the first thing that I see every day.
Right.
And on that particular one with deities, I mean, with mine, and I've had people ask me before too, well, you know, can you interchange this into a different, you know, use it on a different altar or that kind of stuff.
Right.
And personal preference when it comes to deity altars, I don't. Yeah. But we'll go into the tools and that kind of stuff.
Right.
Deities are strictly for deities in comparison to like a working altar.
Exactly.
Or your elemental and that kind of stuff. So
going into the working altar, that's mm-hmm. How would you, or why would you describe that? It's easy to just like compare and contrast. So we've got the personal or the shrine or the, however we want to describe it, our bedroom altar. And then mm-hmm. we've got what I would consider the working altar, which could be in any area, but usually somewhere where you're going to be able to perform ritual, somewhere where you're going to actually be able to function.
Yeah, I mean, my so-called shrine in the bedroom, it stays put. It never gets torn down. It's always there. Where in comparison, you know, I'm looking at it. I have what I call my workstation, and some people will call that a working altar. However, when it comes to actually doing something, I set certain altars up. That my working altar doesn't, you know, like if I'm performing divination or spell work,
right.
That's a completely different, what I call a different type of altar.
Okay.
I don't know what I would call it. And I'm sure some people would call it a working altar, but...
And it's really just whatever works for you. I mean, like, the terminology is just so that we can break it down,
yeah.
But there's...
I mean, I have, like, three different types of altars that I use.
Yeah. And I've got... I don't get to keep any of mine up currently. I do mm-hmm. have one that is just kind of like my secret. It just looks like a bunch of random stuff together, but mm-hmm. it all has meaning for me.
Right.
So that's
what any altar is.
Yeah, and that's currently just, I would call it my everything altar because I don't get to have any differences. So that's
right.
Got a little bit of my deity in it. It's got a little bit of just my personal energy that I want to focus on for the day.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, I can't have a working altar. I can't have a seasonal altar or
Whack.
Something out in public that I would, you know, be able to portray.
Right. And even though we're talking about different types of altars, doesn't mean that you have to have 14,000 different kinds of altars, you know, and it doesn't mean that they have to stay up, or it doesn't mean you have to tear them down all the time. It is a specific location, you know, to do certain things. So whatever works for your lifestyle is fabulous. I mean, again, my deity altar stays up all the time, but that's me because I don't, and it's behind closed doors.
Yeah.
And that, I mean, I don't even think you've even seen my deity altars.
No, I haven't. And I don't, it's not something that, I feel it's almost like your grimoire.
Yeah, it's just
really personal.
Well, I suppose, I think it's more of a matter of, okay, those deities are so special to me. And what they represent, that I don't want anybody touching anything. And even, you know, my closest of friends, if you're approaching, like, my working altar, I want you touching all my shit.
Right.
But my deity altars, I handle that with washed hands and
right.
kids' gloves. You know, that is, like, uber-duber respect.
That's where right all your there. Energy is being directed. And, I mean, a lot of people like to use crystals in specific... you know, the sacred geometry, or they're starting mm-hmm. to include the just how they're able to direct the energy in different patterns. And so there's, oh, you never touch a witch's deity altar, her shrine, her, that really personal one. If it looks like it's a mess, it's that way for a reason. Don't touch it.
But see, my working altar tends to get messy. My deity altar, I keep it as clean as I possibly can.
Clean.
Yeah, that's...
I like putting directional crystals in certain things.
Yeah.
And so it may... It's
that's
in
what
a,
she said.
It's got rhyme and reason,
uh-huh.
but it definitely, to the untrained eye, might not look that way.
Sure. And to the untrained eye, you know, I mean, it's... You know who's laying eyes on your altar, and if you think that they're going to freak out or be offended or even throw criticism your way, then they need to get the fuck away from that thing.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, then why are they in your bedroom?
Exactly. Thank you. So on my shrines, on my deity altars, basically, because I have two,
mm-hmm.
I did my homework on each one of the deities.
Right.
And I found out the things that resonate with them. You know, I have the Morrigan for my female energy, and I have Lou for my masculine.
Mm-hmm.
So I did my homework on either one of them. So they have their specific tools, their mm-hmm. animal totems, their herbs, anything special strictly for them, certain color coordination or correspondences
right.
that go with them. It is all revolved around them. I, on that altar of mine, I don't add a whole lot of my own personal stuff.
Okay.
That is strictly them. And I don't take anything off of those altars unless
right.
I am emptying out herb to come
refresh.
Up with some new. Exactly. Or to cleanse the stones.
Right.
You know, and recharge those and put them back on their altar. Other than that, anything that's on there, I've dedicated to those deities. They belong to them. Does that make sense?
It does. And then the question that comes to mind is, what do you do with that altar or that shrine specifically? Or what do you personally do with it, I should say?
Well, again, and we kind of spoke about this right. in previous podcasts, excuse me, but the deities that I've chosen are parts of me. Okay. For instance, the Morrigan is my strength, where Lou is my creativity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I go to them when I'm lacking or I'm needing, and I need their assistance with things. With that
so
part of me.
So you meditate with them. Or
absolutely.
You connect That's, with them. You ground with
right.
them.
And just because I acknowledge, and it is one big altar, I'm not addressing both, you know, with, you know, equal time or anything. Mm-hmm. I will acknowledge the other one. Hi, Lou. I'm here to see the Morrigan,
right.
you know, bless, you know, kind of thing. And then I will sit there and meditate with her and work with her and allow her to work through me
mm-hmm.
For that. But I'm not doing divination in front of her. I'm not doing spell work. I'm not doing anything special. I'm grounding. I'm becoming balanced.
It's almost like you're calling down the moon, but more focusing with that.
With those deities.
With those deities.
Exactly.
Okay.
So, again, I find a great insult just to approach and not say hello and goodbye
right.
to the other one because, you know, they're both equally important to me. But really, that is what I use those guys for. And again, in the morning when I wake up, they're the first things that I see.
Right.
That's why they're in my bedroom.
I see dead people.
Sometimes. But it's not necessarily to
work yeah. in that way.
I like waking up and seeing them.
Yeah.
And a reminder of who I am, you know, and my strengths. And I don't really, I see them every time I walk into my bedroom, obviously, but it's not like I'm sitting on my knees in front of that altar
right.
all of the time.
It's not the you know, super Christian, pray in front of your
no.
Jesus statue.
No. And it's really nice, too, because I have the altar burned in my brain. I know where everything
yes.
is. And even if I'm at work or something, and if I need to tap in, I can actually close my eyes and see my altar crystal clear
right.
and speak to the Morrigan as though I'm actually in front of her. So it's nice, and it's always the same. I'll bring her fresh flowers and that kind of stuff, but ultimately she stays.
I love the bedroom ones the most because they tend to be the ones that we go to for our happy place. So
mm-hmm.
I think that that's the one that the Buddhists share with us. I think that's the one that a lot of the Hindu religions share, where it's more, they go to appreciate it
okay.
and to connect with something rather than venerate this. I mean, like, there's veneration that goes into the deity, but it's also a place just to reconnect.
Yeah.
Whereas other shrines and other altars are used for different things, and that's like the one that seems to translate to other religions as well.
I like that connection. You know, I use it more for grounding.
Yeah.
I think to keep my head on, you know, screwed on the right way. But in all reality, I think my favorite, the fun one, is my working altar.
That's
oh, that one just
brings
gets
chills.
Trashed.
Yeah.
That one, that one is a lot of fun. It's like, oh wow, this is messy. This is fabulous.
I'm looking forward to having my seasonal altar,
because yeah.
that's going to be more of just the out in the open mm-hmm. daily representation of just the reminder of the season. And so I can get mm-hmm. as artsy fartsy with that as I want, and
oh,
I
sure.
can go really into it. And I mean, like, I get this from my mom, where she loves to decorate for the seasons. And
like
so,
out in the yard? You
oh,
see
yeah.
all the people that have like 50 kabillion lawn decorations for Thanksgiving and then carries on into
oh,
Easter?
Oh, it's ridiculous. And I think that it's just
yeah.
that need to celebrate that season.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's just the Wiccan pagan way of doing it. And so, you know, how much am I already planning for my autumnal altar when I get a chance to do it? Because it's going to be gorgeous.
Yeehaw.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be the cavalry of just gorgeous everything. Mm-hmm. But that's what I look forward to.
Right.
I mean, there's the personal life one, which has to fit with me, and that's going to be consistent throughout the period of time. But that's the one where it's like you can refresh and rejuvenate and really appreciate it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not going to change. It's not something that you have to take down for each Sabbath.
Right.
So, because there's, you've got your seasonal, you've got your elemental, and then you've got ones that are done for a specific ritual or mm-hmm. for a specific Sabbath.
Right. I made, for solitary practice, I made my own small working altar that I can actually bring outside with me. I can bring it anywhere. It's portable. And that one, I think that's the one that gets me in my witchy mode the most, because, I mean, I'm not the greatest painter or anything, but I did paint it myself. I put symbols and certain things on this with the directions and everything like that. And when I bring that out and I have it all set up, and again, it's small, so it gets cluttered really fast. That's the one where it's like I'm on the floor with it and the lights are down, nothing but candles, and there's stuff all over the place. That is the one where I feel the most witchy. That one is really, really cool.
You've seen my linen.
Yeah.
That's how I feel the same way. Like, it's simple.
Right.
I loved the time it took and what I did it with. Like, the mm-hmm. materials to me are just as important, because it's a charcoal-based ink that I made mm-hmm. myself.
Right.
And I, you know, I burnt specific, actually, I burnt negativity papers, like bills cool. and everything, and I turned it into something. So it's okay. Like, you're going to turn into something for my use now.
Right.
And I mean, it's just a piece of linen that I used for, actually, it was leftovers from our hand fasting cloth.
Okay.
But it was just non-dyed, all cotton linen or whatever it is, mm-hmm. and just very simple. And I made my, you know, even if the symbols are incorrect, which some of them are, I still love it because it's so much of me, and it's been with me in each of the rituals I've done.
Right.
So that's, I love my little portable cloth.
And even when it comes to cloths, too, because I have certain types of tapestries, if you will, you know, depending on the mood and the season, too, mm-hmm. you know, and the color correspondences to certain things. You know, if you don't have an altar cloth for, you know, with big, fancy, pagan-type symbols and stuff, that's okay. You know, you can use a nice piece. Use a pretty piece of fabric. But the thing is keep one thing in mind, that once you actually turn that piece of fabric into an altar cloth, let's try to keep it as an altar cloth.
Especially because of how much candle wax is going to be on it in the end.
Not only that, yeah, it's walking from that mundane, human, boring self into your witchier side and kind of building up the witch toy box mm-hmm. kind of thing, and dedicating certain things to nothing but specific importance. Okay, so this new...
It gives it power.
It really does, you know, and it's going to lack in value if it went from being your witch's altar cloth to, you know...
Your tablecloth.
Yeah, right. No, keep it special. So altar cloths, it can be any fabric, it can be any color, textures, you know, it really doesn't matter. Whatever you like,
Whatever fits you.
Right.
Like, it can be as busy or as simple as you want it, and mm-hmm. You know, I don't have to have the most complicated altar pieces, mm-hmm. and mine are by no means the most fantastic or original or even, you know, highest quality made things, but they are my pieces, and that's right. what I'm so proud of.
Right.
So, speaking of the pieces, and I love the story of how I got my athame. It's one of my favorite random stories.
Your big Conan sword looking thing that's amazing that, you could like hack off somebody's head with. That's fucking gorgeous.
That's probably the first tool that everyone, besides a wand. I mean, a wand and an athame pretty much are like the two quintessential altar tools that correlate with things, and ironically, they are intermixed. but I, you know, my athame came to me because a friend had donated it to the haunted house that I was working at.
Mm-hmm.
And he somehow, like, the haunted house owners were playing around with it. And I looked at it and was like, do you know what that is? And just the shape and the fact that it was not sharp and the mm-hmm. fact that it had this naked chick on the hilt. And just, it's, you know, this cheapy recreation Chinese made sword.
Mm-hmm.
But it looked like an athame to me.
And by the way, for those of you who don't know what an athame is, it's a double-sided knife. People come into the shop and they're like, oh, I want to see your knife. And it's like, okay, we actually have a name, just like LeFay was saying. It's called an athame. It's spelled athame, A-T-H-A-M-E.
Right.
We pronounce it athame. Double-bladed, double-edged knife.
Generally not sharp.
It's not sharp. It's not meant to physically cut anything other than energy.
Ever.
So don't have your athame sharpened. It's not necessary.
Okay? Big stickler.
Yeah.
I mean, traditionally, if we want to go into just the basics of an athame, generally, and this does not have to be the case because mine is not this case, generally they come black handled. You have them double-bladed so that they can cut in both directions. And like Feather said, you never cut anything in the mundane world with it.
Right.
So there's people who are so superstitious about it that if it actually does cut something or someone, that it needs to be completely destroyed.
Burn it.
So
I don't think you can burn it.
There's a lot of energy and a lot of power behind these things.
Right. No, they're... You know, again, they're not for cutting anything. There's a difference between our cutlery, and we'll get into the bowling in a second. But I've read in a lot of places, too, the difference in the color of the handles. Mm-hmm. And a lot of customers will often ask, too, does it matter if it's black or white or blah, blah, blah? In my own opinion, no, really. I mean, the things that you read, that was the person's opinion or what they were brought up with. I think that a double-sided cutting instrument that's not sharp can be your athame.
Exactly. Okay? Whatever the material.
You know, I've been drooling on over one that is actually an antler.
Mm-hmm. It's stunning.
It is so pretty, and it goes so beautiful with all my fur and my feathers and stuff. And so I've been drooling over that guy for a while. But mine is very, very basic. I like it. It's small. I'm very small built, so I like things that are very light in my hands.
Yeah.
And
mine is not.
Yeah, yours is, again, Conan She-Ra kind of. Massive gladiator blade. Yours is gorgeous.
It's a huge recreation piece. And so the irony of this story was that this blade was donated to the haunted house because it had survived a house fire,
mm-hmm.
my friend's house fire, and it was one of the only things that actually survived. And he just wanted nothing to do with it. And that mm-hmm. seems to be the story with a lot of the things that I inherit. And I feel
one
bad.
One man's trash is another man's trash.
And it's one man's house burning trash. Yeah. That it's like I've gotten a couple tarot decks the same way.
Right.
Just houses being burnt down.
Yeah.
So things come to you. And the reason why I bring this story up is because so many people go out feeling like they need to build their altar immediately.
No.
And
don't do it.
There's no rhyme or reason to when your tools will come to you.
Right.
Some things are just in the most random of instances, like finding it at the haunted house, and then other instances where you finally saved up enough money to buy that one gorgeous piece.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just the I need to have that moment. But it doesn't have to all come to you at the same time. It takes you years.
And even your athame, I mean, even if you... Okay, well, an athame is not supposed to be sharp. In comparison, we're going to get right into a bowling because they kind of go
hand in hand.
You know, a bowling is the opposite of an athame, and a bowling is actually a single-edged, sharp, small knife. And this is used for actually cutting physical things and not flesh. This is used for chopping your herbs, for inscribing in your candles, for cutting candles.
Kitchen witchery.
Yes, absolutely. So bowlings, single side, sharp cutting herbs and candles. Okay.
Silence!
Athame, we don't cut anything.
I kill you.
But
silence!
Energy. We're cutting through the air, okay? And even with a bowline, if you can't go out and find what is technically called a bowline, if you have one of your favorite kitchen small paring knives...
Oh, yeah, that'll work
okay,
fine.
It works, but again, kind of keep it in the same mind frame as you did with your altar cloth. Once you dedicate it to your witchy side, keep it for your witchy side, okay? You're going to want to cleanse it, dedicate it to spirit and to deity, and say, you know what, from now on, I'm only going to use you with my witchiness.
Yeah, and there's, like, everything with these tools,
mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter what the material is as long as it fits for you.
Right.
Or the style, or whatever it is. Okay, and then going into just alphabetical order, do we want to go into the bell?
Sure. Yeah.
There's really no rhyme or reason to what we pick with this, so I just put it in alphabetical.
Oh, can I go back to one thing with the Athme, though?
Now!
There are certain people that will tell you that Athames belong in certain areas of your altar. Some people will say east, some people say south.
Oh, we should go into the elemental of that one as well, because there's a conflict with that.
And again, there no right or wrong, okay? For me, I like to place my Athame in the direction of south. I look at it as very masculine energy and representing fire, okay? Where some other people will... you know, put it to the east and it represents something completely different. And that's okay.
A lot of time air is the other one that the two get intermixed with.
Right. So if you've got a friend that you see them setting up their altar and their athame is actually located on the east direction of their altar, don't freak out on them. It's okay.
No!
You're doing it wrong! Oh my God!
No!
The world's going to come to an end. No, it's cool. So... But athame, would you agree, more masculine energy?
I tend
type?
To like to associate it with fire, especially mine with its history.
Yeah. Right.
But now I have a conflict with mine because my wand is also very fire
oriented.
Yeah,
your wand is nothing but fire.
It's a jalapeno root. It's
right.
So cool.
Right.
But it's I tend to associate it with fire first and foremost.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So then bell is totally on the opposite end.
Yeah.
And like an athame, it can be anything. Mine is a singing bowl.
Right. You can just a little pick up and you know, whatever. A bell,
anything makes a tone. Anything that makes a nice clean tone that you can meditate to.
Yeah.
Zone out to something.
And, you know, I will admit, I have a singing bowl too, and I have just a small little tabletop bell.
Yeah.
And many of times my bell gets overlooked, you know, because it's one of those smaller tools for me. It's like, oh shit, I forgot to use my bell this ritual. Oh no, it's okay. But the only reason why I really use my bell, mm-hmm. and you tell me how you use yours, is to wake up energy. It's kind of like, hello, okay, class is about to begin, you know, ding, 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 and wake things up. Call deities kind of thing and move the energy about the room. Is that kind of how you...
I mean, like, even when we did the Ostara ritual 2 years ago,
mm-hmm.
And we used the horn mm-hmm. instead, I considered that on the same line of just aligning the vibrational energy in certain ways. There's a tone. I mean, with the singing bells... there's different tones that they emit, and they're supposed to align with different chakras.
Right.
Mine's blue. Mine's supposed to align with the throat chakra. I could, you know, get a purple one. I could get all sorts of different ones to involve different things, but I'm just aligning my mind,
mm-hmm.
and I think I'm aligning that vibrational tone to be directed a little bit better.
Okay.
I mean, there's so much weird science that has to do with tonal vibrations and how that actually affects you. So as long as you've got something that you can really hear at the beginning or at least get in the right mood.
And you know what? If you don't have a bell and you can't afford, you know, you can't afford one or you don't have time to find one, until then, you know what you could do? Clap your hands. Just simply clap your hands in replacing the bell for a moment. You know, seriously, just a couple of times. That's how I started off. And I've seen other... I thought it was crazy.
Yeah.
I'm like, it just like popped in my head, just do this. And then I saw other people doing it. I'm like, yes, I'm not fucking nuts. Other people do it
too.
No,
you make that shockwave noise. I almost, like, if you're in a place where you don't have to be self-conscious,
mm-hmm.
Even just doing the ohm.
Yeah.
Just doing that vibrational, letting a tone go out, and mm-hmm. if you're not self-conscious, because that's one of my hard parts, was just letting that voice go. Pretty much. I mean, like, you're not going to be able to do the double voice vocal cord situation, but just getting that tone in there.
Right.
But I like the clapping idea.
Yeah. So, free.
All right.
If you have hands, if not, use your feet. All right.
Yeah, there
next.
You go.
Next. What's another tool? Well, the besom is on our list, but that's not really an altar tool. It's just a tool that we kind of use.
Yeah, it's... It was more like a ritual tool.
Yeah.
I would consider it more of a ritual tool, but yeah. a lot of people like to include it on their altar.
Yeah.
More or less, I mean, quick use, just basically it's used to metaphysically and metaphorically cleanse the area. You don't really use it to sweep the floors too much unless
right.
you've got a multi-purpose broom that you're okay with doing that.
Right.
But a lot of people have nicer brooms they don't really want to sweep with.
Right. Yeah. And even if you don't have one to, like, swish the air around as you're cleaning out your area, you can sage. There are other ways of cleansing your
yeah.
area. But typically your besom, I mean, besom brooms are also used for other things. I mean, I have one hanging on my wall.
Right.
You know, for something
symbolic,
else.
For
right.
other pieces.
But I do have one that's not terribly witchy looking, but I do enjoy using it for cleansing my area too,
yeah.
along with sage. And is it absolutely necessary? No, it's not. It's just a cool
toy. It's another fun thing to
yeah.
have.
Right.
Ironically, one of the more specifically acknowledged tools, and it's not.
It's like, oh my god, you're a witch. You got a broom on the wall. Fuck yeah, I am.
Yeah, and we barely ever use it.
Right?
So right. cauldron, though, definitely
yeah.
something I consider to be a must-have.
Yes, yes. And if you don't mind, when we're talking about cauldrons, I'm also going to be intervening with sensors, too. Okay.
Big difference.
Okay.
But yes.
yes.
Do we want to just go into...
Go with the cauldron first.
Traditionally, I mean, we're looking at a cast iron three-legged tool. And the three-legged portion was important just because it was symbolic. Three, the magic number.
Mm-hmm.
It was. I'm going to sound bad and not remember what the three legs were meant to represent. Anyway, my theory teacher would be upset with me.
yeah. What's wrong with you?
Really
You're
long.
Not a witch at all.
Yeah, I fail. But they can be of any size. I mean,
oh, yeah.
I'm sure many witches out there are striving to have that crazy hocus pocus style
yeah,
cauldron.
Yeah, you can bathe in it. It's so big.
I want the jacuzzi
want that.
Cauldron.
Yeah.
Think of the fire you'd have to get going
Woo-hoo!
For that.
Yeah,
rocking. Oil toil. Anyway, a lot of people associate it with water primarily, but I was kept reading that it would also be associated with all four elements because you've got fire, you've got earth with
mm-hmm.
whatever you're burning,
mm-hmm.
generally the sage, whatever is included, and then you've got the air for what is being emitted.
The smoke. Right.
Right. So it's kind of a fun all-in-one multi-purpose tool. I mean,
right.
like it can be used for so many different things.
Right.
So,
and the cool thing about them, too, is you can actually buy the small cauldrons that actually have little lids.
Yeah, they're adorable.
Them. So you can actually put out a fire. You can suffocate whatever you've got going on in there if you needed to. And
it's contained. It's not
right.
a big, ridiculous bonfire. I mean, like
it
a lot.
It needs to be about 20% cooler.
And with it being cast iron, too, you don't need any type of a sand or earth. Anything on the bottom of it, you let your charcoal drop it in that bad boy, and then you can burn your,
right.
your incense and everything else on it, or whatever it is that you're wanting to burn.
And just like it's a fun little cooking tip, but it's also just for people who aren't familiar with cast iron. You don't use soap in it ever.
Right.
You don't ever do anything besides a scouring rag because
right.
what it cast iron is super absorbent and will continuously absorb. Whatever you put in there. So the more energy you put into it, the more that sucker is just going to absorb it up.
You're right.
So don't clean your cast iron that way.
Right.
Nope.
All right. I inherited some really nice cast iron pans, and now I had to like learn how to take care of them.
And again, I burn water, so I'll eventually get there in the kitchen. But And I have a very small cauldron, and I do use it. I use my cauldron more for rituals.
Right.
Okay. And yeah,
mine's not a working cauldron. It's there for one reason.
Yeah. When it comes to working stuff, I tend to use a sensor a little bit more. Well, actually, a lot more. And the difference between a cauldron and a sensor is the fact that cauldrons are typically made of cast iron, and right. like you said, have the three legs. Whereas my sensor, and it doesn't
it's
necessarily
big.
Have to be. Yes, it is pretty good size. What would you say about that radius
know, like
right there?
5 inches across.
Yeah,
five,
something
six
like
inches
that.
Across.
And mine is made of copper.
It's so pretty.
It was made in Germany. It does have three legs, which still to me was very important because it looks a whole lot like mm-hmm. a cauldron. It's still, you know, but oh. it is not made of cast iron. And I can still burn. I can still use it on any altar that I choose.
Right.
But it, for me, it's a little bit more versatile. Now, however, because it's not cast iron, I do have to put
treat
something at the base. Yes. Whether it be sand or earth or something like
something
that to put charcoal on, because I'd never put scalding hot charcoal directly in a sensor. I'm going to kill my sensor.
You need something that's going to spread the heat out.
Correct.
Is the big problem.
Right. But it allows me that this size sensor allows me to do a lot more sigil or
yeah,
chaos
there's a lot
magic.
Of burning that,
yeah,
burning
a whole
that
lot
goes
of burning. And when we make red and green and purple
yeah,
fire
it's fun.
In the sensor, it's
the
amazing.
Pyro toy.
Oh, it's, well, what witch is not a pyromaniac?
I don't know.
I haven't met many.
There's some water witches out there.
Yeah. But anyway, the sensor, think of it the same way, you know, what it can be used for as far as a tool.
Right.
And I have seen plenty of people, in fact, one of the ones that I use at the shop, because I don't have my regular working sensor at the shop, I use a planter.
Mm-hmm.
I use a planter, and again, I have something at the bottom of it, and it's just nice and big. Throw shit in there, let it burn. It's a safe, controlled environment. You know, if I have to put something over the top of it, I can.
Pretty much we're just looking for ways of having fire indoors without burning ourselves down.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like...
Exactly. Take out the batteries out of your smoke detector.
Yeah, that's... ironic that we should be so obsessed with fire when we should historically be more afraid of it.
I do not scare easily.
Okay, moving on to another fire element thing. If we want to go just down the line.
Wow. We're really going to get into candles? We have to keep this briefly.
Briefly.
Okay.
Not going into it deeply.
Okay.
All right. So you've generally got 6 candles minimal,
mm-hmm.
I'd say.
Yeah.
Because you've got your elemental candles.
North, south, east, west.
Exactly. Colors usually corresponding with
red,
them.
Red, yellow, green, blue.
Generally. But whatever colors fit your liking.
Right.
And then you've got your deity candles.
Right.
So that can be anything representing your deities. Mm-hmm. I did a really simple ritual last time where it was black and yellow.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, no color specific why. I mean, the black and the yellow could have been male and female, vice versa, but that's just what I picked that time.
You know, and typically I'll do gold for mm-hmm. the lord and silver for the lady.
Right,
you know?
That's a good common.
It really doesn't matter. I've used just pure white for deity.
Yeah,
as well.
Everything can, it's, the color correspondences are hugely numbered, and it's really per your discretion.
Mm-hmm. Like, and even outside the elementals, because they're going to be on the outskirts of your altar, you know, towards the edge of it in the directions of north, south, east, and west.
Or even on the outer side of your circle.
Right, right. Depending on how big of a space that you're making. And then your lord and lady and the spirit, they're going to be right in the center. But you can still have, what do you call them, illuminator candles?
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, pyro here, you know, I want all my lights out. And I want a lot of fire in the room.
It makes the environment so much more fun.
Just be careful, because then when you're wearing your witchy clothing kind of thing, and you're like, look at me, I'm like, you know, Rihanna. And next thing you know, you're up in flames and your hair's on fire, and that's just not good. So we use a lot of candles because it's gorgeous and it just like
and
totally
I tend
crazy
to wear
ambiance.
Floofy clothes.
Just don't catch your shit on fire, please. Be careful.
Have a fire extinguisher close by and don't drink too much out of the chalice before you're done. That's just
I like
good,
that. Okay.
Good common rules.
All right.
So going into the chalice, because candles could go into this huge thing. We'll go into each of these individually. I mean. Some of them could have more. Candle magic itself is its own section.
And just, I have to throw this in just for the safety issue, because I did mention a fire extinguisher, and even though this is totally not witchy, okay, this just doesn't sound cool, fucking do it anyway. Another bad idea to have very, very close by is some baking soda, too.
Yeah.
Okay, please, just, no matter what you do, always practice safety first.
Just
okay, especially
do it.
Yes, mm-hmm. Just fucking do it, because the last thing that's a total mood kill is when shit's going and everything's on fire and you need things to help you put it out quickly and safely.
The fire is creation and destruction. Don't
yeah.
fuck with it too
so
much.
So fire extinguisher close by. And some baking soda for those of you who will eventually be working with some chemicals and stuff, so please. All right, sorry, I'll get off of that now. I don't know. Safety first.
It's important.
Okay, chalice time. Chalice.
All right.
Have some wine.
This one is, you know, this one the Christians directly took from us. Directly.
Thief.
Very easily.
Christian!
No, ma'am. Okay. So this one is more associated with water, pretty obviously why it's the most symbolically feminine,
mm-hmm.
generally representing the lady in some way or another. And so a lot of the times that's when the libations are sent around, and usually
that's what she said.
That's when you can break out the wine. That's when you can break out your juice, whatever you decide mm-hmm. to. But it's, you share it amongst if you're solitary, you share it with yourself and the deities and whoever you've brought forth. If mm-hmm. you're in a group, you share it with others.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the sharing portion of it, because we always used to say to each other, may you never thirst.
Okay.
And it was like its own little blessing.
Okay.
So say we all!
Mm-hmm. I've used it for other things too. Certain spells call for certain things.
Yeah.
Even not only drinking out of, but I've dipped like the edge of my athame into
yes.
a chalice of water. I've anointed, certain tools from the water of my mm-hmm. chalice.
Making moon water in it. Or...
Sure. You know, it is. It is the representation of the womb.
Right.
You know, so cleansing, mostly cleansing.
Right.
Especially for me. That's where my brain goes as soon as I go to the chalice with the blessed water inside of it. Or drink, if you're drinking like what you were talking about. Have some wine.
Yeah. So that's one, it's pretty self-explanatory, but mm-hmm. I don't see many altars, ritual altars, that don't include a chalice somewhere. So that's just another one. And a lot of the times they will associate it with water, so that's going to be more in
the west. To the left.
To the left.
West. Blue. Mm-hmm. Water. All right. Next.
On to the next one. This one is not necessary all the time, but I do remember being told this in Wicca 101, so mm-hmm. just wanted to include it, was the paton, or mm-hmm. the pentacle representation.
Right. And it doesn't have to be a pentacle. I've seen plenty of, like, triquetra,
yes.
other symbols.
Or the labyrinth.
Right. And you will actually find some altar cloths, that was the first one that we talked about, that will have symbols on them already. And if it's that symbol is right in the center of your altar, guess what? There's your altar.
That's how
symbol.
Mine is included. My altar
right.
cloth has a pentacle or a pentagram on it.
Right. And, you know, there are plenty of times where I just have a pretty piece of cloth that I feel like using for my altar cloth, and it doesn't have any type of symbol on it.
Mm-hmm.
So then I will have an altar tile.
Right.
Or even if I... Even if you don't have one and you don't have the money for one, take a piece of paper and draw a pentacle on
it. You can make it out of anything.
And slap it right in the center of your table. Guess what? There you go. It works.
All it needs to do is represent the elements.
Ta-da! Look at you. Look what you have created.
You've got your four elements, earth, mm-hmm. air, water, and fire, and then you've got spirit.
Spirit.
So that's what the 5 points represent, and that's mm-hmm. all you need to represent on your altar. A piece of paper or some gold embroidered, whatever it is. It can be as simple or as complicated as you want it to be.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of like, yeah, it is the center of everything that you're doing. It is really concentrating on everything that's coming together. You, the elements, and deity all in one. Boop, right there in the middle.
And then really, I mean, after that, the big one that everybody recognizes.
Yeah, there's really not, yeah,
We don't have that many more. I mean, like, just the wand has to be the thing that everybody recognizes. I mean, you're a witch, you've got a wand.
No, I don't. I don't. I have a feather.
Okay, so.
I am not a real witch. Blah.
Remove the witch card.
No, okay, no. Wand.
So, why... That's important, though. Mm-hmm. So, what is the point of a wand? It's energy direction.
Right. And remember in the beginning we were talking about athames, and some people will place them on the east side of their altar, which represents air. Okay? And then some people will put their athames on the south direction, representing fire. I prefer my wand... Okay, to be east, where my athame is south.
Right.
Because it does represent, the wand represents the east and air. So instead of a stick, instead of wood.
Instead of an earth element.
Correct. I have actually chosen more, what I consider more air, which is a beautiful feather.
It's gorgeous.
It is absolutely gorgeous. It was a gift, and I've had it for
you baby buku. That thing.
Oh my gosh! If it touch, you know me. I know. Won't even let it touch the ground.
I know.
I will flip shit if anything happens to that feather. But yeah, go ahead.
No, and that's what I love. The fact is, okay, Harry Potter fans out there, J.K. Mm-hmm. Rowling is not, you know, all knowing, all seeing. Wands are important. Don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. My first wand that I wanted to make, and eventually it will be made.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just really slow at this one because I don't know this craft yet, and eventually I have to learn it. It's made out of a willow branch.
Nice.
Willow is associated with water. Has absolutely nothing to do with air. Has nothing to do
it's
with
okay.
fire. But then I broke down and had to buy one of the bewitching wands because it was made out of jalapeno root. And
well, I remember when I first met you, I felt like such an asshole because you showed me this beautiful wand that you were working on, and you left it on the floor, and I didn't.
Yeah.
Go to warn you that I had a new puppy and she ate it.
Yeah.
I know. It was like, oh God, here goes my friendship. She's going to hate me forever.
And I don't get me wrong. I loved that wand, but it never felt strong to me. It never felt like something I was connected with. It was more or less like an art project.
Yeah.
So I was, you know, it gave me an excuse to get the jalapeno
one that you have now.
It's so pretty. And that's where I'm tied whenever I do ritual, because now I've got this jalapeno root that just screams fire.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely screams fire. And my athame, which is blessed by fire.
Right.
Destructive fire, but still, I mean, like, it's got fire marks on it. And it's so cool. So I tend to still use my fire wand as my earth, or as my, not my that. As my air element for the moment, just because I feel like the athame is such a masculine representation.
Okay.
But in either way, you're looking at those as phallic images. It's just the representation of masculine energy. When you get down to it, it's directing energy and it's masculine.
Right. And the thing that a lot of people, it's like, I get asked often too, it's like, well, why are these really necessary? Are they really necessary? Well, these are tools, and eventually, yes, you are going to want to eventually grab some of these tools and add them to your altar. Is it absolutely necessary in the very beginning?
No.
Because in all reality, say for instance, an athame or a wand or what I use, a feather, you're holding it in typically your dominant hand, which is your giving hand. So when you're casting a circle, or you're using any of these implements, the energy starts from within.
And
so it comes from within you, and then out through your arm, out through your hand, into the thing that you're holding, and out through that. So it's going from human energy into an earthly or a fire type energy. It's a tool. But your finger is just as good. Your finger. That's why your mama, any good mama, raised you to say you never fucking point your finger at anybody.
Yeah.
Okay? Because you're actually directing energy at somebody. So if you ever stick your finger in my face, it better be with good intention, because I will bite that fucker off. Because I know... yeah.
And I've got all these fingers in my face.
You know, because it's very true. You do not point your finger in a negative intent, but when it comes to energy work, most definitely use your finger until you get some tools.
Yeah, it's super important just to remember that it's not all going to come to you at once.
I mean,
your altar will build itself as time goes on.
Yep.
I mean, yeah, I'm sure as shop owners, you want to say, go out and buy everything all at once, but that's...
Actually, we deter people from doing that.
You can't bond with things right. all at once. You're going right. to have this entire shopping bag that you're supposed to bond and cleanse.
And then it becomes overwhelming.
And yeah. you're not going to have the same connection. Those right. Each item should have a story. Each item should... or it doesn't have
not
to have a story.
A story.
But each item should stick out in your mind when you... Right. collected it, when it became a part of your toolkit.
It becomes very important. It becomes sacred.
Yes.
It really does. So, yeah, and you need time to cleanse it, to charge it, to connect it, to dedicate it.
Yeah.
All of these things. So start off simple. And if you only have a cloth to begin with, that's fucking cool. You've got a fucking cloth. You know, and even an altar itself,
mm-hmm.
okay, and a lot of people will ask this too, what do I use? Use a fucking box. I don't care, baby. If you don't have money for this beautiful oak-carved lion foot fucking claw
crazy,
table that's insane that I would kill somebody for, that's okay. You know, even if you don't have a cardboard box, dedicate a space on the floor. I don't fucking care. It's,
make
you know,
it
right
your
there.
Space.
Because your altars aren't always used indoors. You bring your altars outside, too.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not like you can always bring an altar table outside. So you start off with little things. You'll eventually add to your arsenal, I promise. And just like you said, LeFay, I mean, it all comes in time and they should be important.
Yes.
So.
All right. I had a mini list. We don't have to go into any of these. It's just there's so many other things that can get included that we didn't mention.
But I do, and you're right, there are 10 million different things that you can add to your altar. However, one thing that I really kind of want to close off
yeah.
with is that we were talking about, we were incorporating some of the elemental aspects
mm-hmm.
into these tools.
Yes.
When it comes to, we know now that the East, it represents air.
Right.
So you can either use your choice of athame or a wand or a feather in comparison to
south.
The south, which is fire. Okay. So you have your athame or whatever you do.
Whatever you've decided.
Right. And that's where your fire, your candles go and that type of thing. Whereas your west typically is more of your chalice. It's your water.
Right.
Okay.
We didn't cover
but
one
north,
element.
North, and I—that's what stuck out because I'm
Fair
an
enough.
Earth girl.
Absolutely.
I'm an earth girl, and
miss?
You fucking leave out earth, and I'm gonna like get pissy. So, when it comes to something, a tool
yeah.
for the north, even if it's a small bowl of blessed salt,
yes,
that is actually considered a tool because salt is a tool, and you will use it for other things.
Any different things.
Right. When we eventually start talking about casting circles and that kind of stuff,
mm-hmm.
that tool will come into play. So keep that in mind. You will be incorporating an earth element, which is north, as well. I had to finish off with
Absolutely.
That.
And then I would include, I like to include gemstones as my representation.
Yeah.
Just
okay.
because I use it for a different thing, but as
mm-hmm.
long as I have a representation of earth somewhere, or my petrified wood, or
right.
my amber, or something.
Even a plant.
That's always a good one.
You know, a small plant. Okay. Again, 10 million other things that we can put on our altar. We just wanted to go over the basics.
Okay, so now on to a much more entertaining subject. The one that you've been looking forward to talking about all week.
I'm like drooling over here. And I shouldn't be this excited because, you know, I don't want to treat our podcast as a complete venting, you know, source. But when it comes to these types of topics, yes, I'm going to get a little bit passionate. Yeah, I'm going to get a lot. I'm going to be swearing a lot. So, anyway.
Bear with us.
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to...
Okay, here we go. Psychic vampires. What are they, LeFay?
All right, so really basic descriptions. It's somebody who is draining you emotionally, either mentally or empathically. And then there's also the metaphorical sense where somebody just leaves you feeling exhausted, unfocused, depressed, or just, you know, even Anton LeVay... says they say that he coined this term back in the 60s, but he describes, you know, he had some points around him. He describes it as a person who's spiritually or emotionally weak person who drains vital energy from other people or paranormal entities such as within such a person, allowing the psychic draining of energy from other people. those sucky people that end up just draining you after you interact with them.
Let's not talk about the whole paranormal vampires here, okay? We're just going to stick
this
strictly,
with
human. Yeah, okay. Cool. All right. Go ahead. Sorry.
The most epic. Okay. Yes, maybe they were the reference, but okay, historically, not looking at the Dracula vampires. There's people that have always drained energy. Seriously. There's just people that we know in our day-to-day lives, and for as long as people can remember, there's been just those people that drain you, either because they're narcissistic, either because they're the woe-is-me victim type, or they control the situation. And I'm not saying that I can't be an energy vampire from time to time. Trust
me. We all are.
Yes.
That is a key point. Yeah. Each one of us has psychic vampire tendencies that sometimes need to be put into check. None of us are non-vampires. However, we keep it in check. And that's kind of what this is getting into. None of us are holier than thou and I would never be a vampire, man. No. All of us are.
No, and human interaction requires energy transference. I mean, right. This book that I got to read, The Celestine Prophecy, really, really interesting book. And they go into the concept of energy transference, and there's people that will drain. There's givers and there's takers.
Right.
And whenever you have positive interactions, you raise energy. Whenever you have negative interactions, either the person who is performing the negative action mm-hmm. will drain energy off of you, and you feel more, your energy becomes low.
Right.
And that just naturally is how humans behave, whether you want to look at it in a metaphysical sense or in just a psychological sense.
Right.
It's really important to remember that this is not just spiritual. This is something that very physical and can be quantified and can be studied. You see parents who can act like the worst kinds of energy vampires. And I'm not saying, I am not pointing out one person or another, but that kind of that relationship specifically
right.
has a tendency to be a feeding and psychological vampire moment. A lot easier than creating a boundary is so much more difficult between a parent and a child.
It's, well, the children don't have much of a choice.
Yeah,
they're subjected to this constant feeding from their parents. And yeah, that's... I'm not going to disagree with you on that at all. And I know that everybody listening to us right now knows what it feels like to be sucked dry by what they would call a psychic vampire. And there's energy vampires, too.
Yeah.
And
they could be different things. I mean, they could
yes.
be considered the same thing, or you can go into a much deeper description of each of them and see them as two different things. We're not going to go into that because I'm not even 100% sure on that.
Yeah, I have a very brief, very, very small definition that I kind of liked. The difference, psychic vampires are those which are born with an internal need, a physical need for the life energy, okay, which they themselves cannot supply.
Okay.
Okay, in comparison to an emotional vampire. And actually, I found that this one was kind of interesting. It's a little bit longer. It says it's the act of manipulation. The act of manipulating another into an intense, desired emotional state, such as love, passion, anger, in order to absorb the resulting emotional energy.
Ooh,
emotional vampires,
like
they include such practices as learning what someone needs in a mate and accentuating those traits so that the person thinks he or she is in love. That is fucked
That's
up.
That's terrifying.
That is fucked up.
I know exactly
I know
who that
a
is.
Lot.
Oh my gosh. She's terrifying too.
There are, you know, when it comes to this energy work, that
exactly.
They're such thing as intentionally doing things and unintentionally doing
yes.
things, okay? And I firmly believe that the majority of the people, they are vampires, but maybe they don't realize that they are, and they don't really mean to
do
just
it.
Suck you dry, even though they're fucking, yeah, you want to drown them. It's the people that intentionally do it that get
and
off on it.
Get off of it.
And they do. It's like that dickhead of a boss that you have.
Who just does nasty shit just for the sake of, or the ones that the drama causers.
The drama, yeah, drama queens are in their whole other category of, yeah,
like I have a description of these separate ones, and that I know there's other terms for it. I mean, like, we're all going to have different names for it. So,
right.
I mean, like, the one that I have the least problems with,
mm-hmm.
because I don't have the patience for it, is the woe is me victims.
Oh, my God.
And
go fucking pad your pockets of rocks and go drown yourself. I'm so fucking sick of hearing your bullshit. Now, don't get me wrong. I know that there are some people out there that really need help. Some serious help. They need therapy. They need medication. These are the people that are, you know, even borderline suicidal. And they are not crying wolf. They are very fucking serious.
Absolutely.
And I am not talking about these people. I'm making that perfectly clear right now. But that is a small percentage of the people that fucking annoy the crap out of
perspective.
Me.
Perspective. There's a lack of perspective that gets involved.
Yeah. So, you know, if you seriously have those deep emotional problems, you know, those issues, we really, really hope that you get the proper help that you need. We are not talking about you.
No, and
we are talking
don't
about...
Don't be afraid to reach out. Don't ever be afraid to reach out. If you think that you're being an energy vampire, don't take this as a don't talk to somebody. That's by no means what we're saying. It's... Everyone has to become aware of it.
Right.
So this is, we're hoping that this will help you recognize potential behavior patterns that you can learn to grow from. And that's all we ever wish to help with.
We are talking about the people that you're consistently surrounded with that always have, like what you said, LeFay, the woe is me. I mean, every fucking time you come around me, you don't have anything positive to say whatsoever. It is like, God, my life is so shitty. This is going on, and I want my boyfriend to love me, and blah, 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 fucking blah. Oh, my God, soap opera-rama.
Bring it back to, like, I got to bring in the technology. It's when you see on Facebook people posting up a picture of them in their bikini saying how ugly they are. They will comment fish. They will... It goes even further than them just face-to-face interaction. It has to be the self-degrading, self-loathing.
Look at me.
I need attention.
I'm sexy and I know it.
I feel bad, or that, you know, everything in my life is constantly falling apart. And it's turned, a lot of people have turned to Facebook to get that instant gratification and that instant.
Well, that's because Facebook has 20 kabillion people on it. And what a quick, easy way of getting all kinds of responses, which is a crock of shit because you're never going to meet all these people. You know, you have no idea if what they're even saying to you is even genuine.
It's not support. It's not real support.
No, not at all. You know, that I don't like psychic vampires anyway. Now you throw in Facebook and I'm just going to fucking like start pulling out my hair. That's a double whammy to me and I can't stand either one of them.
Yeah, and I just have to shut it down. I generally will not comment on those kind of posts.
I will not feed that kind of shit. I refuse. I can't do it. It's
too much energy. I'm not going to allow myself to be drained by this.
Well... And that is going to bring up an interesting thing at the end of actually a crucial point that I want to make after we talk about the blood suckers. But right now, do you know somebody, and I know that you do, that when they are in your presence, that and you were fucking great before they walked into your living room, and then by the time they left, you felt like you need to sleep for a week. And your head is splitting open. You want to vomit. I mean, you're so disgusted and so drained that it's like, oh my God, they have completely sucked out every good molecule of positivity that you have.
See, it's, I did in my, okay, I know of these people, but I don't know why, but I don't have that same effect with direct one-on-one, unless it's the kind of person that, like, my old, in a different life, previous boss of mine was a huge emotional vampire, and she really completely made me feel like the worst human being constantly, but she did this to a different degree and level. The people that I deal with on a day-to-day basis now, a lot of them do it unintentionally, and I'm able to see that that's what's happening in a psychological standpoint and go,
yes.
Okay, I know that that's what you're wanting. I'm not going to give it to you, mainly because I just, you know, fuck you.
And
I don't want to deal with that,
right.
And I'm not going to let you drain me. But I had to learn that.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, go back before you learned it, okay? Because a lot of people have not learned that yet. So what I'm trying to express is the fact that people need to recognize what they are.
Yes.
Okay? That these are symptoms that come over you when you are in the presence of a psychic vampire.
It physically
or an emotional
affects
vampire.
You beyond what... I mean, there's friends that will be able to pump you up. And then there's that one friend that shows up and it's like the Debbie Downer. I mean, Mad TV had that one person. And I mean, headaches and physical body ache and just
muscle tension.
Yeah.
You feel stressed out.
And you start to look at your own situation and you start to like mentally. You start having, like, it changes your way of thinking half the time.
And it goes so deep that it will fuck up your sleep patterns, too.
Yeah. And you especially know, if you're really sensitive.
Yes. When it comes to, again, you woke up, you were feeling fine, you put yourself in a room full of people, and then when you dismiss yourself from it and you feel different... If you are not aware, you have been attacked, basically, by energy-sucking humans that have fed off of you. And these people may knowingly or unknowingly have done this to you.
Right.
And by realizing that that is what they have done to you, now you have a choice. Especially if it's a friend of yours.
Right.
Okay.
It's creating, you have to first find a boundary. You have to find what is you. And I mean, again, looking in introspective, you have to know where your state of mind is first so that you know that you're being affected.
Yeah. Awareness is definitely key. And these are certain, I mean, there are certain ways, preventive and corrective means when it comes to dealing with psychic vampires. but even getting back to the psychic vampires themselves. Okay, let's go back to the one, like the, when I had described the energy vampire.
Right. The manipulator.
You. Yeah. And the crazy thing is that most of the people that I've come in contact with that do this, that are guilty of this, are female.
Right.
Okay. And it is usually the one that wants to be loved so much that she finds this guy and she will do anything for him to love her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything. And he wants, you know, he prefers blonde. So what does she do? She bleaches her hair. Okay. He wants big boobs. She'll go out and she'll get a tit job.
Right.
You know, whatever he wants, she will do so that he so-called loves her kind of thing. And then she's the one that turns around and complains and bitches that he's such an asshole.
Fuck off!
Okay. What? No, don't come crying victim to me. You know, that he doesn't fucking love you. Look at what you have done.
You're not saying even that created. You've created a facade of yourself.
You have become a fucking monster, okay? And hopefully, he's smart enough to not have fed into you and said, "You know what, bitch? You're a loser."
Right.
And I'm gonna go find somebody who thinks more of themselves.
Right.
And on that note, a lot of vampires just like what you said, don't think highly of themselves. They feel negative. They feel low. They feel depressed. They are unhappy. And they have to feed off of people that are positive, that are strong, and that are happy.
Right.
Okay? Because then that makes their dick hard. And it's like, oh, great. Now I feel great. You know, I always feel like shit until I talk to you. And then I just feel so much better. And I'm thinking to myself, bitch, I would so fucking bring you to the middle of the woods and I'd come out by myself. That's how much I dislike you because you're such a fucking downer. And it'd be different if I was really trying to help you and I thought it was making a difference.
Right.
No, you thrive off of that. You purposely seek out people that will stroke your ego.
Fuck off!
There's directions where it's called like the victim vampire, and a lot of times that one in particular tends to be the one that happens the most often. I think out of just when you start to think that the world is against you, it's easy to fall into that behavior pattern and that thought process constantly because the more negative things start happening to you, and it's just this big snowball effect.
And then you're so quick to sit there and point your finger and say it's everybody else's fault. You are the stupid bitch. You have created your own reality. You're living it. Why are you sucking everybody else into your fucking hole?
Dumbass!
You know,
seriously. And then refusing to do anything. I mean, when people are constantly talking to you and they give you this advice and that advice and there's so many different options and you just sit there in wallowing, then what's the point?
Because actually making a change is difficult. Oh my God, that's scary, you know? I would much rather sit here and bitch about it. Because you're my friend, and you're the positive one, and you're going to sit here and you're going to pet me and brush my hair.
And tell me how
and
wonderful
make me
I am.
Feel all yeah, right. Gun. And then I'm going to go home, and then I'm going to wake up in the morning, and I'm going to feed off you some more. No. No, no, no. And the crazy thing is there's people that they keep opening the door to this fucking vampire to them every day.
Sometimes it's your best friend.
No.
I mean, a lot of best friend relationships are that give and take. And, okay, it's not, I don't think that this is an uncommon behavior. And I don't think that when it's rare or when it's mutual and when you can, when it's.
Yes, I know what you're saying.
Yeah, there's a give and take, and we don't want to say that if they are able to give back and be supportive to you, then that's just a relationship. That's
a vampire is a user.
Right.
They take and they never fucking give back. Ever. Okay? But I know some vampires that will compensate because they don't know how to emotionally give back.
Right.
So what they do is they compensate by, let's say, buying a gift. You know, I'm so sorry. I was such a twat and just like completely destroyed your day. Here, I bought you a fucking cupcake. What? No, do you really think that a fucking cupcake is going to give me back all the energy that you sucked from me? No, you are still, you're taking. You're taking and not reciprocating. Okay? Right. You are not giving back. And those are the types of people. It's that one-way street. Okay? That is unacceptable.
Right. And that's when you need to learn how to create boundaries. Like, one of the first... I mean, there's a lot of different ways of working with this. And some aspects are not going to work because of how the relationship is set up. If you've got, you know, a friend, it's going to be a lot easier to create a boundary with them than it is a parent, than it is a boss. There's certain things that you can't do in the real world, and that's when you start to include magic.
Well, I am a big one, and I've said it a lot of times, too. Typically, most people will respond in a very passive-aggressive way, okay? And I think that empowerment stems from assertion over aggression.
Okay.
Okay? So learning to be more assertive to people that you know, that you have become completely aware of what they're doing. They are taking right. from you and not giving anything back. So being able to stand your ground, okay? And even if it means, you know, saying, hey, you know what? I love you and I don't want our friendship to end, but I cannot stand the fact that this is how you make me feel.
Right.
And I have, you know, I've all the right in the world to say that to you because it is honest. That is honestly how you're making me feel. And if we can work this out to the point where, oh, you didn't realize you were doing that. Well, now you do. And I love you and I want to help you. But if you don't change, guess what? You are out of my life.
Right. Shut you are physically and mentally exhausting me to the point where I can't function.
Right.
And if you confronting them can be probably the hardest thing to do sometimes for a lot of people, especially highly empathic people that
Don't get me on the empaths right now. Yeah.
People that are susceptible to energy vampires tend to be very sweet and easy to talk to people that dislike confrontation.
But I'm going to... That's the other extreme of it, though.
Right.
Okay? Is that you have now become... And because you brought it up, the empath.
Yeah.
I plan on talking about that a little while. You are no longer an empath. You're a martyr.
Right.
Okay?
You're and allowing martyrs, it to happen.
Martyrs are no better than the vampires themselves. Honestly. Because if you are so in tune with what's going on, you know, you can
then
pick
you
up those things. Then you should know better. You should have the strength to say, I am not going to allow this to happen because I've been given a gift to be able to help people and you are not helping me. You are harming me. So if you're going to turn around and say, I can't help it. I'm an empath and I just pick up on everybody and then everybody just drains me, blah, 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 blah. You are now sucking me dry
right.
by the shit that's coming out of your mouth. Because it's like, you know what? Seriously? No. You need to learn to grow some balls. You know? And you need to make these fucking people stop doing what you're doing so that you can help the people that are worth helping. Most psychic vampires, they don't want to be helped. They like listening. They like starting drama. How many fucking bitches do you know that just love going into a room of happiness and saying, watch what I can do, and then just destroy and walk out laughing?
They get a kick out of it. And I mean, it's...
Fuck yeah, they do.
Internet trolls are one of the new... Not new, but they're one of the new breeds of psychic vampires. They constantly feed off of negative comments. They feed off of trolling people. They feed off of... just dealing out negative
you
energy.
You are pussies. All of you trolls, you're fucking pussy cunts. Yes, I said that.
So, that's all they are. And it's just, even if it's just an outright comment, just to piss somebody off, that's all it takes for them mm-hmm. to get a kick out of it. And either you've got a bulldog in the back that can, you know, make them back down.
Right.
Or you don't feed into it.
Well, that... So it really depends. We do definitely have to control our emotions.
Right.
Because you do have those vampires that can push a button and it's just like instant reaction. And it's like, okay, why am I going to sit there and exert this energy on this piece of shit person that I could care less if they drop off the face of the planet tomorrow? In fact, I wish that you would. Okay. So I can either walk away or I can sit there and I can toy with you.
Right.
But toying with a vampire, it takes some practice to toy with a vampire because you have to know that you're going to win against the vampire. You have to completely shut them out, if not annihilate them.
Surprise, motherfucker.
To the point. Exactly. You have to know your opponent. But most of the time, unless you are 100% confident, you are right. It is better to completely distance yourself from them and learn that type of personality and do your best to stay away from those types of people until you do become strong.
Right.
Of course. Run away.
And then you have to, I mean, once you know yourself, once you know the triggers, the things that you can recognize as psychic vampirism, is like once you know that you're being attacked, it's so much easier to catch yourself doing it. And then once you're able to... In the psychology form, once you're able to observe yourself doing it and others doing it, it gets so much easier to recognize it. And then it's just easier, even if you don't have to include any energy into it, just saying, okay, this is what they're asking for and what they're needing. Why would they be needing that? And break it down.
Just when I think you couldn't.
I think, you know, again, none of us are completely squeaky clean of
right.
not doing this. And I think that a lot of the awareness of our own actions comes with maturity.
Mm-hmm.
And with maturity comes the responsibility of even when we are being douchebags.
Right.
Okay. And yes, I know that there are times, and I tend to be a little more introverted. You know, I deal with my own issues myself. Mm-hmm. There's very rarely that I will reach out to people unless it's like, dude, I have dissected this 15,000 different ways and I need, you know, a friend's perspective.
You need
this.
To vent. Everyone right. needs a chance to vent.
And, but at the same time too, you know, if I wake up and I'm just on the rag and I'm totally PMSing and chicking out and stuff, and I'm like, you know, and at the end of it, I realized that night, it's like, wow, I was a complete fucking menopause, or you just like psycho estrogen filled person. The big girl is going to call you up and say, you know what? I don't know why I did what I did. I just like verbally vomited all over you. And thank you so much for listening to me. And
right.
in all reality,
and show appreciation.
Yes.
For
because without you, you know, maybe I didn't even want to hear what you had to say. I just needed to vent.
Right.
And I appreciate that. And you know what? When you are in that exact same moon that I was just in, I'm going to allow you to vomit all over me too.
Right.
But the thing is there's a difference. You know, friends do bounce that kind of shit off of each other. But a real friend doesn't sit there and use their so-called friend and only taking and taking and taking and not showing respect, you know, and gratitude for what their friend has to give them.
Right.
If you have somebody that is always taking things from you, always taking and not thanking you, that's a big key too. You know, and I know that certain people will show appreciation in certain ways, but seriously, again, if you're going to sit there with me all fucking night and drain me and then try to compensate by, you know, giving me
some
a cupcake,
sort of monetary that, response.
Yeah, that's I know my worth.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
No, I know my worth, and I am so much more. I'm worth fuckload more than a cupcake.
I'm better than a cupcake. It's hard though when you deal with some of the other ones that are not so direct, like the ones that are more in an area, more in your workplace, especially that,
yes.
that those are difficult because it's, you have restrictions. They are just like flies.
That's a fly. I thought that was a really long fart. I'm sorry. It's just like, but yeah, I hear you. You even had your old boss.
Yeah. And whether it's your boss or your coworker or right. somebody that's affecting just the general environment that mm-hmm. you're in, there's certain times where you can't just be direct with them.
And yeah, I mean, there's definitely a time and a place for everything. And vampires that are feeding off of you at work, that is really, really shitty because mm-hmm. you have to try to maintain a professional attitude so that you don't get in trouble. Okay. So in a friendship, like day to day thing, you can easily say, you know what? I choose to walk away from you and you're gone. You're history. But at the workplace, you still have some choices. You really do. I mean, it may only be two breaks a day plus a lunch break, but you know what? You can have those. You should take those. You have to realize that you aren't paid for every second that you are there. So if you're allowed a break, you need to go take your break. And your lunch, yeah, Braveheart, get up, fuck you, douchebags.
Oh,
anyway.
Bruce Willis. What? Oh, wow, Bruce Willis. Mel Gibson.
What?
Mel Gibson, I know this one.
Ow, spank her. Lunch break, walk away. If anybody tries to follow you, you know, tell them to fuck off. You are not being paid. Okay? Go sit in your car. Go listen to some music. Eat your fucking sandwich. Meditate. Go sit under a tree. Go take off your shoes. Walk
Ground.
Through the grass.
Do something that's going to make you
right.
disconnect.
Exactly. You have to have breathers from these things that you're surrounded with at work.
And then learn to compartmentalize. I think that's a really important day-to-day activity just for when you're away from that, going into your taking a break, learning to be able to separate you from mm-hmm. the vampire. Knowing that vampire, even if it's, you know, you have to go see them the next day, they're not going to be with you at every instance of every day. You can separate from them somewhere, even if it's that for that 15 minutes.
And yeah, and sometimes that may be all that you have. I have a girlfriend that is surrounded by nothing but women. And these women are very, very catty, and they are very superficial. And this particular friend of mine, she is trying to do some spiritual cleansing. She's trying not to be so catty and so estrogen-filled, you know, so earthy.
Right.
Kind of earthly, not earthy, earthly. And so it's not just one person that she's up against. It's the rest.
Whole area.
It's the whole area. And that's very difficult. It's very stressful, and that it really eats away at her. And it's to the point where she's talking about finding a different job. And when it comes down to that, I mean, excuse me, you may have to. And unless you learn to get strong enough where you can stand up against an army of, you know, bitches, you know, if you're that strong, then you know what? You may be the new guru in the place, and they may actually follow trend.
Right.
That would be really cool if you were that strong. But if you are not, and it's actually affecting you deeply, you may seriously want to go find a different place to work. Because that's just not a healthy environment.
Okay, so we've got the black and the white of either being able to defend it just mentally or having to separate yourself from the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Things that could aid in sticking it out. So I wanted to go into some additional things that you can use besides just your mental capacities of being able to... I mean, like, you can meditate, you can ground, you can do all of those things to break yourself away from it, but while you're in that situation... When you have to cope with that, there's other mechanisms that you can incorporate. So, I mean, like, there's tools. There's stuff that you can use, or there's spells, and there's rituals, and some things that we have included on our blog.
Yes. I actually had a tool that I brought to work with me once, and it was an onyx raven.
Nice.
And I had this female that was just, oh, my God, problem is we were both very hard-headed, and we just could not see eye to eye. We just really hated each other, and it was an empowered tool that really, it kept her distance from me, and it worked. But that really does fall into more of a spell work, you know, spell work type of thing.
Right.
But there are plenty of times where you can, like you said, you can meditate and call upon a deity for help. You know, if you don't have...
Requesting patience, requesting some more strength or courage or... I mean, Freya is a great one for just being able to stand your ground.
Right.
There's Sparta!
Yeah!
There's creating energy shields, you know, grounding, centering.
Visualization.
You know. What is this thing? Okay, I'm sorry. That's wire between my legs.
I mean, we can go into spells that include different things to aid in that. But then, I mean, like, I like carrying around stones just for general. I mean, like, even my jewelry is all specifically, like, whatever stones I have on are there for a specific reason. And
yeah, and I like to call those more energy shields.
Yeah.
Okay, kind of thing. You know, they could be stones, amulets.
Mm-hmm. Talismans. You
know, talisman. Aromatherapy, especially with amulets, is amazing. And you can incorporate aromatherapy. Well, not everybody can. It really depends on the line of work that you're at, because some professions, it's like fragrance-free.
Really
exactly.
Important.
So you have to be very careful. But if not, aromatherapy really, really helps too. Keeping it natural. And again, your stones and that type of thing, which you can keep nice and discreet. Or like what I had, it was blatantly blaring, you know.
It was
on my desk and staring at her, and she stayed a good 10 feet away from me.
And if you include the fact that, I mean, generally, not all stones in for everything, but I'm seeing a trend, and black stones tend to be a really great protection stone.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, like, I've got, you know, smoky quartz is listed, and then it's got hematite, jet, black onyx, black obsidian, Apache tear, which isn't just black all the time, but, you know, all of these black stones mm-hmm. that are really promoting protection and defense.
Okay, and I am not going to disagree. However, I'm going to give you something different to look at
yes.
for a moment, okay? Instead of having that, and when I think of that, I think of, all right, they've already negatively impacted me, and now I need this stone to help me.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to look at a decoy stone, and I'm going to use garnet. Garnet.
Nice.
Think about it, okay? The darker red varieties, naturally protective and emanates life force energy, which is a decoy for vampires to drain that instead of your energy.
Very cool.
So it's actually kind of a neat concept too. Instead of allowing them to drain you and then you revamping, mm-hmm. okay, reducing.
Which a lot of the quartz would be better for.
Yeah. If you know your girlfriend is a psychic vampire, give her a piece of garnet when she's near you. She's feeding off the energy of the stone rather than your own aura.
Okay.
Kind of neat, yes? If you don't actually give her one or have one on the table between you and her,
right.
If you wear one, instead of her vamping off of your aura, your energy field, it's again coming from the nice big chunk of really dark red garnet.
Yeah, it's just really pretty stone.
Oh, it's freaking gorgeous. So think of it, blood. All
yeah.
right? So they're not draining
Essence.
Your blood. They're draining the blood of the stone. So garnet is one of my top favorites.
Okay, so in that sense,
mm-hmm.
I would want to include amber under that same ground.
Okay.
It in itself has its own life force that's really strong, but it does such a good job of just, you know, preventing the loss of energy,
okay.
is what it's saying. So it's more like a, I don't know, I feel like it's a natural battery, better than quartz in some ways, because it's, I like that it's so connected with Earth mm-hmm. as much as it is everything else. But then I do feel like it helps me stay, it's like more of a shell.
Okay.
So it's less of a chance for them to even get in within the energy draining field.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of like your garnet, but not letting them feed off of it in general, just having that it's not going to drain.
Okay.
So stopping the energy flow.
And on that note, and besides the freaking, it's one of my favorite colors, your amber. It is.
Well, there's so many different colors too.
I know, but I just want to eat it. Anyway, my uber favorite stone, which is labradorite. Okay. Spectralite is amazing for this, working with psychic vampires as well, because it actually builds a protective shield around you. Okay. It seals holes and tears in your aura. Plus, it helps in spotting deceptive people.
Ooh.
So before they can even do any damage to you, it opens up that third eye so that you can recognize that you actually have a vampire in your midst.
That's just as important. That's
cool?
one of the biggest steps.
Preventive rather than corrective.
Right.
I'm a big preventive girl. So if you can spot them and stop them dead in their tracks before they can do anything, fuck yeah. I mean, that's just like, and that's fun too.
Yeah. Because then, I mean, like, it's so much more. I do get a little bit of a boner just being able to say, it's like, I know what you're doing. Fuck you.
Yeah.
I'm not going to let this happen.
So again, you can either walk away or you can sit there and totally fuck with them.
Right. And just, they keep trying. They'll just keep trying and pulling.
And I will kill you.
Yeah. Just where they're draining and the tendrils are going out. And, mm-hmm. you know, I'm so sad lately. Yeah, you know, my shit's been going around like this, and and
you don't feed it.
Right. And it just, you can tell that they're just like,
give it back to them. Even though the shit that I'm spewing at you, it's totally right. I could be lying my ass off. I'm just being just as fucking pathetic as you are right now. And you don't like it. Why? Because I'm not feeding you.
Oh,
so then
good
you get bored with
it,
with the conversation really fast, and then you wander away.
Right.
And that's what I wanted. You know, now that actually spares me from saying, you know what? You're a twat. You are a user, life-sucking twat.
It's the leech, you know, that can't find a meal. It has to move on to another donor.
But just being aware that preventive, definitely. I'm all about the preventive over the corrective. But even when it comes to corrective, because a lot of people don't even realize that they're being fed off of
it.
It's like, dude, you know what? You make a really good point. And this person in my life, they are a vampire. They're completely sucking me dry. I have all the symptoms of being fed off of.
And there's nothing you can do about it. for the moment. I mean, until circumstances change, there's not a whole lot that you can do and address directly.
Well, there's one big one, and it ties in with what you keep bringing in as far as Facebook and the workplace and being around girlfriends.
Yes.
Okay. Remember how last episode we were talking about the witch's pyramid?
Yes.
Okay. And the final one was to be silent. Shut your face. Why do you have to go around telling everybody and their fucking grandma all your goddamn business? And then now the world knows everything. And now everybody knows everything about you. And then you're wondering why people are feeding off of you. Seriously? Okay, that's like going to work and spilling out all of your dirty laundry. Okay?
So you're addressing the victim or the vampire currently?
The so-called victim.
Okay.
The so-called victim. They actually opened the door to the vampire by doing that kind of thing. Okay? By... You know, I'm trying to think of a really good example for you, but it's, here. In fact, I think, yeah. The thing is to quit oversharing. Quit oversharing so much personal information about yourself.
Right.
Okay? Because if you don't know how to handle people, when you give out information, that is arsenal for people to use against you. Right?
I would agree.
Okay. So if you're going to put something out there that could potentially come back and bite you, then don't put it out there.
Well, that's just good common sense on the internet regardless.
Okay. Here's an example. This is the one that I was trying to think of. Mm-hmm. Okay. Say, for instance, I'm single, which I'm not. Okay. But I'm single and I'm trying to get back with my ex-boyfriend or something.
Okay.
The last person that I want to be talking to is my psychic vampire girlfriend in regards to that.
Right. Okay? Because they're going to...
It just turns into a big mishmash of bullshit.
Right.
It really does. You have just created a pot of drama right there. And the thing is, and you don't even realize that you're doing it. Okay. It's... I so want to put names to this, and I can't. I promise myself that I would not do this.
Anyway, the oversharing, though, ends up being a thing where the vampires can use that as, like, a leeching point.
Yes. Yes.
I would agree, but, like, at the workplace and everything, there's times where you don't have to say anything. Like, naturally, I don't talk a lot at the workplace as is, but people just come at you constantly or are expecting things of you, or you can just sit there and, like, you can be impolite by just turning around and not dealing with them, or you can mentally shield yourself and, you know, they just let it bounce off of you is what I end up having to do much of the time because I can't. With my environment at my current place, you know, drama is easy because we're a smaller company.
Yeah.
And interactions are so specific and it's normally a very nice thing. But if there's drama, the drama spreads like wildfire. So being polite and is just my fail safe in general.
I have such a hard time being polite. They are... I have that sharp badger tongue, you know, and when I turn people away, they either find me boring or bitchy, one or the other. And you know what? And I don't care because, yes, if I rudely turn my back to you and tell you, you know what, you're boring me, you need to fuck off, that's the bitch, okay? Or the person that just sits there and looks at you without saying a word. And I have absolutely nothing to feed off of what you're trying to do.
Right.
Now I've become boring. Either way, you're not affecting me. So call me a bore, call me a bitch. I don't care. I'm not letting you drain me anymore. But another reoccurring thing that I see, even with the so-called empaths, you know, is that even when I'm talking to them, I will ask, is this like a lot of people doing this to you? Like, you know, like zombie horde, you know, all these needy people just sucking off of you because you're an empath? No, it's just two people.
Right.
Why do you let them to continue to do it to you? You haven't learned the first 14 times that this is what they're doing to you, okay? Weak people need to feed off of strong people. They really do. But if you are supposedly strong, you're strong enough to be able to stand up for yourself and recognize the fact of what they're doing. Why? Why are you bitching about the exact same situation or the exact same person over and over
again? It's just a continuous loop at this point. I mean, the victim becomes the vampire going to somebody else and...
The martyr.
Right. Well, I mean, like, when it's martyr and they go to somebody else, isn't it just them being a vampire then?
They are. That's why I said they are no better than the vampire.
Right.
You know, and... when it comes to working with them in a workplace, it is difficult. It really, really is. Because we are at work 40 hours a week, which tends to be more time spent there than in our home life. So, yes, these people... And you didn't choose these people. You chose the job. They just came with it. And it really sucks because there's a large percentage of the people that you're going to be working with that you just fucking clash with.
And no
matter
really lucky.
What.
I'm really, really lucky at my position. I will say that.
There are a lot of people that aren't.
Just people and humans in general. You could have the best environment in the world and still have energy drainage occurring somewhere.
How about new?
But the thing that is so simple, and people don't get it maybe because it is too simple, is the fact that energy has to come and energy has to go. The balance, that is what makes you healthy.
Right.
And I'm not just talking mentally or spiritually, physically healthy too.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot only take and take and take and take and not give back. Your body will fail you. It will fail you. You cannot just give and give and give and give and not receive. Your body will fail you.
Right.
You have to give and take. You have to. It's
self-preservation.
You're defeating yourself if you think that you can get away without giving back. You know, number one, you're not going to have any fucking friends.
Right.
Because everybody on the ground is going to
push everyone away.
Exactly. You're physically going to fall apart, mentally and spiritually going to fall apart.
You're going to be disconnected from everything.
Right. But at the same time, by only giving and giving and giving and giving all of the fucking time too, and not standing up, you won't. And that is the disturbing, sad, sick thing about this world, is that if you allow this life to chew you up and spit you out, okay? And then the day that you die defeated like that, guess what? The very next day, the world still wakes up and they go on and you aren't missed.
And continue taking.
It is a sad reality. This is a very... It's a cruel world out there. You have to learn to be strong out there against... How many people are out there walking around now?
8 billion?
8 billion?
Something like that? I could be wrong.
So even when it comes to how to work with these kinds of things, whether you have been attacked, you know, if you're trying to get the shit off of you, clean up your aura.
Just defend it.
Yeah, heal up the holes. Preventive and corrective. Yeah, I think we're going to be putting some basic spell work on our blog as well.
Yeah, some simple spells and simple ideas.
Right.
I'll be putting my notes up there like always, and that's got some reference guides and different... I included a couple different herbs and spells that we might be able to work out, but
mm-hmm.
I like preventative measures more so than
corrective.
Healing measures, yeah. But honestly, grounding and meditation and reconnecting and just rejuicing myself tends to be the best healing property
for
me.
But before you can do that, you have to walk away from what it is that is hurting you. Meaning, walk away from the vamps, go to seclusion, realize you need to lick your wounds. So you need to heal your shit and then protect it. But before you put that protective barrier up...
Get it all out.
Get it out and empower yourself. Learn from your mistakes, dummy. Stop letting the world fucking do this shit to you.
Yes.
Okay? Because if not, you're going to, every other day, you're going to be coming home and licking your wounds and fixing the tears in your aura.
And that's called insanity.
Blah, blah, blah. No. Stop relying on magic and deity to do all the fucking protection work for you. Grow some fucking balls, get some strength, then protect your shit, and know that you can walk down a path, and it doesn't matter if you're attacked by 16 fucking vampires.
Just do it!
They can't fucking touch you. And that is a really, that's a powerful feeling, knowing that you don't let people vamp off of you like that.
Yes. Outside of kind of like just the basics of cleansing, grounding, purging, and getting all the connected, I really am a big fan of having a physical reminder like a talisman, just as a, even if it's a meditative point, if it's something, I mean, like I've got my Labradorite that I wear on a consistent basis, but one of my favorites, and we were going to hold this off, and I think this is like my favorite way of doing this, is our two favorite ways of dealing with energy vampires. And I've got two, you've got two, we didn't discuss this beforehand, but one of my favorites that you actually sell at the shop, and my mom uses it, is a little piece of mirror. And it's in this gorgeous little pendant, and it's got this half moon mirror and everything, and she's got her little rhyme that goes with it, and it makes so much sense, and it's just, I'm rubber, you're glue.
Okay.
Whatever bounces off me sticks to you, but it means exactly what it means. That mirror is going to deflect whatever negative vampiric energy is coming her way and just deflect it.
Okay.
And even if it's just a reminder to not let it affect her, and it's, if it was a placebo effect or if it's actually working in the sense of bouncing off negative energy, it helps her. And I really like that. And it's even just in the most simplest terms, because people will ask her all the time and she explains it in that way, and everybody gets it.
Right. Yeah, I even labeled that. I know exactly what you're talking about, that little pendant. It's adorable. And that's a waning moon.
Yeah.
It is more of a reversal type. It's used for reversal spells, even. And even that smallest thing that she did, that is actually a small spell.
Yeah.
It really is. And on that, it's kind of, even though I come across as this really hard bitch and everything, I mean, obviously I'm doing this with you because I genuinely do, I want to help. I do. Even though I say I despise humans, you know, I'm learning to coexist with humans, and I do want to help. But when it comes to working with vampires, number one, you can't help anybody who does not want to be helped. Okay? If I have to actually rely, or not have to, but if I choose to want to help you using magic, I will use a reversal spell on you. Not on you in particular, but
on
a vampire. Absolutely. And it's more of, number one, I'm throwing the energy back at you. Okay? And number two, it really forces you to taste your own medicine. We don't like yucky taste in medicine. And that's exactly what you've been throwing out. So really, that's one of the biggest
eye-opening.
Oh, it is. And instead of a binding or banishing spell against the person to stop being a vampire, with those, they don't understand why they're, you know.
Right. And
anyway,
it's not
going
to be able
that,
to come back on you super harsh. And
right.
There's no three... three times law.
Right. So you like your little... reversal mirrors.
My mom likes using that. Yeah.
Okay. What else do you use?
This one is my more personal one. And this one was when I'm working on becoming more of an offensive person with my rituals and spells and everything. But I still have that more, I'm comfortable with defensive naturally. As my first knee-jerk reaction is I'm going to do something defensively. And when I was trying to deal with this one particular, like, emotional vampire, straight on, as hardcore as it could be, and there was not a whole lot that I could do in my physical circumstances, my mentor back in LA described to me this sparkly curtain thing, and it was a visualization, but it was pretty much imagining this fountain of mirrors and glitter and anything reflective that would come from the top of your head, where you're just, where everything, your intuition starts, and shower down on you. And it's this intense visualization where everything negative could no longer come through that curtain, but everything positive could interact easily and move within that curtain. And it's just a really strong visualization, but that's it, you know, it makes me focus because I have to focus on those details. And then I'm able to just, I know that curtain's there.
Okay.
And it helps. It helps me, and, you know, if I'm feeling particularly drained, because then I know that I have my own energy field. And some people don't have to do a sparkly curtain. Some people will do just a white light or an eggshell or something like that.
Yeah, it's very centering. That's in comparison to grounding. The centering is invoking the white light.
Right.
And that protective barrier around you.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a form of centering.
That's a good... I'm big into the visualizations.
Okay.
So that's my personal preference for generic... environmental mm-hmm. vampirism, not, you know, one person specifically, but just, you know, I'm going to be dealing with a lot of crap today.
Right.
I'd rather just, you know, have my guard up.
Okay. And I'm a big animal girl.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And mine really does go hand in hand with yours. But when it comes to needing, especially some border,
yeah.
I work with armadillo.
Okay.
Okay. He is
total shell.
Yeah. He knows those boundaries. Okay. And if he does feel threatened, he knows how to, you know, seal up in that ball. He looks mm-hmm. like this massive roly-poly, and he's really hard to get to.
Right.
I mean, there are other animals, such as tortoise, that can do the same thing, go inside the shell and everything. But armadillo is a little different. But it is still talking about that border, you know, creating boundaries
right.
kind of thing. I, however, that is good for certain situations, especially if you don't know the group of people that you're going to go into,
mm-hmm.
and it may be very intimidating situation. So you call upon armadillo. But if you know the group of people that you're about to walk into,
mm-hmm.
okay, you know these people like the back of your hand.
This person's this way.
Yeah,
and
I'm about to walk into that. I'm not an armadillo.
Right.
I am a fucking tiger, okay? And I will eat you. I will eat you. And it's... all you little vampire things, all you little gnats and stuff, I'm not going in being all, you know, like, oh, if you look at me wrong, I'm going to hide or, you know, emanate all this white light. No, I am going to fucking turn into dragon mode and just, like, flames are going to come shooting out of my ass and all of you guys are going to go up in smoke. So it's more of a matter of if I have to be aggressive, I will be aggressive. I prefer to be assertive. Okay, where I just stand my grounds and say, hey, you know, I don't want to go to war with you, but knowing that if I have to, I will win.
Right. I mean, like, I can respect it and look forward to working towards that kind of mentality because it mm-hmm. seems very freeing.
Oh, it's amazing.
I'm not quite there yet, and I know it. So, again, that's where I'm saying. It's like I need to work on my offensive behavior. I'm naturally a defensive, like, weird extroverted introvert kind of thing. But, I mean, I'm, you know, it's every day's a progress.
Yeah. Step by step, every day, a little bit stronger than you were the day before. But that's why I'm teaching you how to play chess.
And I had, like, three moves ahead at the moment, and then my brain starts to hurt and fizzle out.
Yeah. No, it's really, you know, once you start empowering yourself, everything around you changes. And the psychic vampires, they will bounce off of you. They really will. They will realize even before they come to you, you know, you will be so strong. You are not at all. And they'll just look at you and take a step back and go, okay, I'm going to go feed off of her. You know, they're not stupid people. They really aren't. They are not ignorant whatsoever, especially the ones that have that intention. They know exactly what they're doing.
Right. And that's, I mean, we're not blaming the unintentional ones. We're hoping that this will aid in self-recognition. Because we all do it. And then the ones that are intentionally doing it, we hope that you've all learned how to defend against that so that you can, you know, succeed in life and, I don't know, be a little bit happier.
One more last thing, though, too. Please do your friends a favor. If you have friends that you feel feed off of you and you honestly think that they're doing it unintentionally, grow some balls and have a conversation with them. Okay, because they may not know that they're doing it.
You could save a friendship.
You really, really could. You could actually earn a lot of respect from that person by standing up and saying, hey, you know what? You're affecting me. I love you. Let's work on this. Okay? Do yourself a favor. Stand up for yourself and say no more. Do your friend a favor and bring it to their attention. Maybe they do know that they're doing it. Okay? And if that's true,
Then
you need to walk away. You need to walk away from that person. Okay? If they don't know And every time they start being all vampy on you again, doing the exact same bad habit that they've been stuck in forever, catch them every single time and say, and tell them, stop fucking vamping. You're vamping. And it's not cute and it's not funny. You know, and it's not like, hee hee, oh, look at you, you're a vamp again. No, fuck that. It's negative behavior.
I love you, but you're going to hurt this friendship.
Right, right. If you really want to be my friend, shut your fucking hole. Be positive. Give me something.
Shut up!
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Right.
On that note, I'm feeling like we pretty much covered everything we possibly could about vampires without turning this into a total bitch fest.
Actually, I thought that I would be Feng Shui is cool too, and the work.
Oh yeah. Everything else. Okay, so we've gotten into a little bit
feng
more preventative things
read
that
about
you can
it.
Do.
Read about it. Read about Feng Shui.
All right, so I had my notes real quick. The idea of things that you could do to make yourself feel better after a psychic vampire attack, and so one of them that I put down was using Feng Shui in your home, and you've lent me the little Feng Shui book, and I'm getting slowly through it.
Workplace too. It works wonderful.
Changing your environment. Changing Feng Shui is really about directing the
energy. Yes.
In your environment. And so if you're able to include mirrors, or if you're able to include just different directions that things are pointing, that's going to help free up some of that flow of energy and hopefully get you in a better mood.
With the internet, look up Feng Shui. Look it up.
It's available. It's
everywhere. Yeah, it is really, really cool. And if you don't know how to spell it, because it sounds like Feng, F-U-N-G, it's F-E-N-G, S-H-U-I, Feng Shui. Feng Shui. Feng Shui. I don't know. That's how you spell it. Look it up. Look at some different techniques and apply it to your workspace.
Yes.
Because it actually really helps.
And then find out whatever music you energetically connect with. Like, I found on Reddit somebody wondering if you could connect with EDM. Absolutely. I totally agree. I listen to dubstep or certain things that get me connected and amped up.
Mm-hmm.
It's energy. Whatever makes you... if you feel like listening to Enya, because that's mm-hmm. going to vibe, get you in the right energy, that's great. I need some fast, heavy-paced, crazy stuff if I want to feel like my energy is high again. So, you know, if it's drums or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But there's so many different ways of connecting and just re-energizing yourself. I said earlier, quartz crystals tend to be really good batteries. Mm-hmm. So as long as you have something that's been charged, stick it out in the moon for a couple nights.
Right.
And then you've got your own little battery pack.
Yeah. Another thing is too, is clean your house. Not, I mean, literally. I mean, yeah, you could literally,
cleanse
if you want
your house.
To, cleanse your house. You know, if there's a lot of things that remind you of vampires in your midst, okay, you know.
Those people,
yeah,
specifically. Not Dracula vampires.
Right. Right. We're not talking about that kind of stuff. But, yeah, it's, you know, Miss Susie Q here, every time she comes over, God, just even thinking of her just depresses me so badly. And, oh, shit, she forgot her fucking hairbrush here. Get rid of the fucking thing.
Keep it
it's
out of
linked
your area.
To her. Yeah, you, when you, it comes to walking away from that shit, you really need to walk away. It could be an ex, too. Okay?
Pictures, old books, old
clean
things.
Clean house. Right. Get rid of all the vampire stuff.
And then, I mean, it's kind of difficult to say, but separating yourself from negative, you know, postings, negative, you know, television, TV, radio shows, newspapers, books, magazines, and like social media in general, that's really difficult to stay away from the negativity, but
it's opening the door to your vampire.
It's attraction, and attraction is going to bring in more crap. So if you just separate yourself, even if it's just limiting your access to Facebook, limiting your what you're going to check out, blocking them, unfollowing somebody, just staying out of that circle so that you don't have to be reminded. It'll fall away.
Even in Hollywood, they portray a vampire cannot cross your threshold unless invited. Okay? They for some reason, I don't know, it's, they just can't do it. Well, that is so true in your everyday life too. Psychic vampires cannot do anything to you unless you open the door for that to happen. Or you put yourself in a room full of vampires.
You allow it to happen.
Right.
One way
absolutely.
Or another.
So if you do get bit, get back, learn from the experience, get strong, become aware, and be prepared to become a vampire slayer, okay? So that you don't have to walk around and bitching and moaning that, you know, everybody's a psychic vamp. Everybody's feeding off of me. You know what? Shut up. learn how to deal with them, empower, strengthen, heal, protect,
and this
carry
just
on
makes
bravely.
You a happier person in general.
Oh God, yeah.
I mean, like in general, this is just healthy behavior in to know yourself, to look inwards always, and this is self development and growth again.
Yep.
So, hopefully, we can take some positive message away from this, and everyone can walk away knowing that they're stronger and better than anyone leads you to be, believe, really.
Yeah, and, you know, even if you feel like you've been defeated, and you're starting from scratch, that's okay. Awareness is the first key. So, lick your wounds, fix your shit, get strong, protect yourself, use whatever means you have to.
Don't take no shit.
Right, right. And then get back out there, because it's the only way you're going to learn and get stronger. But we only say this because we care about you.
All right, on that note, I'm LeFay.
This is Feather.
And thank you very, very, very much for joining us for this episode of Season of the Witch. Check out our blog for the follow-up notes and some additional spells.
Yeah.
Find us on Facebook. We're on iTunes, Podbean, and YouTube. And we'll see you all next time.
Be safe.
Must be the season of the witch.